Well, I'm sorry. I must have dozed off while viewing the film we're going to be taking a look at today. Chock full of continuity errors, flub lines of dialogue, and misspelled words during the opening credits, Demon Queen is truly a grueling exercise in movie watching. And to make matters worse, the film only runs 55 minutes long, but if you were to remove the opening and closing credits, really, the movie would only be 48 minutes long.
So why does Demon Queen exist in the first place? During the home video boom of the 1980s, distributors were so desperate for new product to add to their catalogs that they would release just about anything they could get their hands on. Notorious shot-on-video offenders like Cannibal Campout, The Video Dead, Black Devil Doll from Hell, and Redneck Zombies are just a few examples of the bottom-of-the-barrel homemade endurance test that populated video store shelves. Unfortunately for us, director Donald Farmer decided to fire up his own trusty camcorder and throw his hat into the ring.
Why does that image look so familiar to me? Wait a minute, that box art doesn't belong to this movie?
That gruesome artwork is just a cropped section of a poster made for an Italian zombie movie that was released a few years prior called Nightmare City. Demon Queen doesn't even try to cover up the fact that it stole artwork from a different movie. The filmmakers even flaunt the plagiarized image during the opening credits. Yep, this is ours. We didn't blatantly rip this off from Nightmare City at all, we promise. Cliff Dance's bone, huh? Well, which bone is he? Crazy bone? Busy bone? Funny bone? Silly bone? Broken bone? Bloody bone? Movie bone? Bad continuity bone? The artist formerly known as Bone? Music composed and pre-formed by Jan Haflin. Hope her pre-formance is top-notch. Angle Fire is in this movie? That's my favorite song! Why would you even bother copywriting a shitty misspelled song in the first place? Oh, so somebody doesn't steal it from you and claim it as their own? Post-opening credits, we cut to a sleazy hotel where we are introduced to characters the film almost wants us to care about.
You know, I still can't believe how I ran into you tonight. I mean, we've never met, right? But it's like, in the back of my mind, I've known you. Like I've always known you. Crazy. Am I making any sense?
Maybe.
Then retreated to a steamy session in bed, including sexy tummy scratching and chest rubbing. Most directors of photography have a trusty bag of various fancy camera lenses they use to shoot a scene, but I guess David Reed decided to shoot this scene with a lens smeared in grease in order to realize Donald Farmer's extraordinary vision. Due to it being shot on tape, damn near every shot in this movie appears smeared and greasy. Alright, let's get everybody an orange spray tan and you. Smear this bloody loofah all over your nude body. Yeah, that's erotic. Let's shoot. What is that on top of that skyscraper? Are these even real buildings? Or just Bob Ross paintings of buildings? They could have saved money and not shoot this by hiring somebody to paint this shot, because the shoddy VHS quality is about equivalent to a smeared canvas anyway. It's interesting that this film showcases stolen artwork from other movies, but doesn't boast a cameo by bearded Bruce Valanche.
Jess, I can't be buying that stuff anymore. My probation officer's on my ass.
You know, I wouldn't normally do this. I'm a businessman. You know that, Luther. But today only, a special sale price, 20% off.
Jesse is quite the businessman, pitching a 20% discount deal normally offered by supermarkets, not drug dealers.
I ain't buying that stuff no more. I ain't. And I'm going.
You have to be a bottom-of-the-barrel degenerate to scare away Bruce Valanche. Our drug-peddling protagonist is promptly chased down an alley by a shit-brown-painted Volkswagen while knocking over garbage cans in the wrong direction, unsuccessfully attempting to stall it. Running directly into a wall probably isn't the most efficient form of escape. Turns out Jesse owes a midget Chuck Norris named Izzy $6,000, and he's here with his henchman Bone to collect.
Hey, are we the only ones that paid $6,000 for that shit? You got 10 seconds to explain, you got 15 seconds to give us our fucking money back.
How can this guy threaten anyone? He's more pants than man. Jesse is saved when the mysterious woman from earlier, who likes to caress sponges soaked in blood all over herself, shows up and takes a bite out of Bone's jugular, resulting in a 10-second long death scene.
Plausible, yes. But should we as a viewer be subjected to it? No! God, no!
Jesus! What the fuck happened to him?
Just get the hell out of here, okay?
They weren't even looking at a dead body. Just script pages scattered all over the ground.
Sure, let's go.
Is that even the same guy? Did the previous actor deem himself too good for Demon Queen after filming his initial death scene?
Hey, can we rest for a minute?
You walked 5 feet. A trip to the bathroom takes longer than that.
So you live nearby?
Yeah, a few blocks away.
It's gonna take them a few days to get there at the rate they're going. With nowhere close by for her to stay, Jesse ends up offering Lucinda a place to crash for saving his life, but first he has to smooth things over with his coke-snorting girlfriend. What the hell was that? It appears during editing, mere frames of a random house were left in the film during that transition. Did director Donald Farmer simply record over home movies he had lying around the house, and those frames went unnoticed?
Shit, it's just you.
I suppose that's as realistic a reaction somebody startled while doing cocaine would have.
This ain't a customer. This is a girl. She needs a place to crash.
Maybe she can stay at the abandoned house 2 frames next door.
A girl? And you're bringing her here? With us?
Listen, Bone Izzy just tried to do a number on my body. They banged this girl around. But somehow, she scared him off. I don't know how.
Don't know how? What about his gaping neck wound? He slipped and fell on a sharp midget? Lucinda makes herself at home, bringing along an oversized poster of the fucking movie. How meta does Demon Queen want to be? They stole the image from the opening credits and made a poster out of it, but that image was already stolen. I can't tell if this is a close-up shot of a painting, an exterior shot, a painting of an exterior shot, or just a close-up shot of a shitty painting. It's revealed Jesse wears his red kimono to bed and has epileptic seizures while presumably dreaming about paintings. He's launched into a Madonna music video and transforms into Boris Karloff from Frankenstein, which is the highlight of this movie so far. The biggest honor for Demon Queen would have been for a critic's quote to be slapped on the front cover exclaiming, "One of the actors looks like Boris Karloff in one scene, so I guess that's kinda cool." I don't even know what I'm watching here. What's going on with the tape in this shot? Did somebody have to confess later, "Sorry, Don, I accidentally urinated on the side of your movie"? Demon Queen proves that anything is possible in dream sequences with just a little imagination, like Boris Karloff now transforming into Steve Guttenberg. I could be wrong here, but I don't think directly licking a woman's sternum is what gets them going. Was this film marketed toward people with a sternum fetish? Demon Queen could easily be praised for the lengthiest sternum licking scene in movie history, mainly because it's the only film in movie history to feature a prolonged sternum licking scene. This sternum tastes like snozzberries.
Okay, well, that's enough of this movie. I think I'm done here. I can't do this one anymore, so I'm out.
I'll see you later.
I'll go get him.
Wait, what? No!
Looks like Mola Ram's got some hardy competition here.
Kalima. Kalima.
Yeah, you love your heart.
So you're not gonna let me leave after seeing that? Hey, is that Sigourney Weaver over there?
For real? I swear to God.
Because this scene was shot illegally in a shopping mall on VHS tape, the names of each store are inadvertently blurred out. What does that say? Taco Vulva? Oh, Taco Viva. 30 seconds of this riveting escalator riding scene, and I still can't tell who the fuck that is.
Things I'd rather be doing than watching Demon Queen. Watching The African Queen starring Humphrey Bogart and Katharine Hepburn. Not watching Demon Queen. Having Queen Bee funneled directly into my urethra.
Is that the lead singer from Styx? I didn't recognize him from not currently performing Styx. Either you're gonna buy me an Orange Julius, or you're singing the chorus to Mr. Roboto. Some films have missing reels, but it seems like Demon Queen has a missing VHS tape, because we're transported to a hotel room where another victim has been slain. We know it's a hotel room because of the television displaying white noise, and not that movie starring Michael Keaton, because that would have been a better film to watch than this. We find out that Lucinda's demon powers can resurrect her murdered victims and use them as pawns to chase after embarrassed actresses who can never escape from the fact they appeared in this movie. I regret being in Demon Queen! Soundtrack provided by synthetic sound effects of people playing ping pong. For no other reason than to pad the film out even further, we cut to a video store where we suffer through a scene completely unrelated to anything we've watched in the movie thus far.
Are you interested in violence?
There's proper video renting etiquette. That man digging through his ass is violence.
You don't suppose my customers are getting jaded and bored with sex and violence, do you?
Well, it might be that Maybe they should be looking for something that's more horrible than anybody could imagine.
Like what?
Well, like,
Oh my god, I said horror, not horrible.
Uh-oh, Demon Queen is becoming self-aware. After that irrelevant departure from the plot, if you can even call it that, we find Bone has also been brought back from the dead and attacks Izzy.
Hungry.
Sure, man, anything you want.
However, an unlucky bimbo looking to score some coke shows up and interrupts Bone's meal.
Izzy? Izzy?
Hey, do you think she's wondering to herself, is he even home? No? Nothing?
And of course, no shot on video horror film would be complete without a pivotal performance from the cameraman's shadow. I guess the score need not apply here. That's okay. We can just listen to the grass. Excuse me, your angle fire? This song is obviously about an isosceles triangle. Unfortunately for Wendy, Lucinda hates songs about isosceles triangles. I guess the music wasn't coming from her headphones after all. Maybe if I turn the volume up on her bloody neck wound, I can hear angle fire a little bit better. We cut back to the video store for another pointless scene. Hey, you got any video rentals? I'm a new character! Jeffrey Dahmer, the video store clerk, years.
Hey, lady. Can I, help you?
No, I'm just looking for a movie. Something romantic.
I suppose you're only looking for the, mainstream stuff, with Sally Fields, Meryl Streep, stuff like that, huh?
We've also got plenty of movies starring Diane Keaton's. Pretty in Pink just came out with Molly Ringwald's if you'd be interested in renting that. If not, you can always follow me down the classic movie section where we keep everything starring Grace Kelly's.
Do you have the new one with Barbara Streisand?
I got the latest one with Frances Raines.
I'm sorry, but I don't think you can help me. Good night.
Hey, lady. Hey, lady!
Do they have Jerry Lewis working here?
Women. Well, it's a shame, too. I was gonna warn her that there's a crazed killer on the loose.
But I won't now, because she didn't rent a movie. We can assume this woman is stalked and murdered because she still hasn't returned her copy of Yentl. Something tells me the director didn't request his actress to smirk while being strangled in this scene, but he didn't have an extra few feet left of VHS tape for a second take. Oh my god, what's smeared on the lens? Oh, it's the movie. Jesse returns home after a 15-minute absence, nearly half the movie's runtime, and discovers his dead girlfriend, only to disregard it completely and receive courtesy return sternum attention.
I had to do it, Jesse. You understand, don't you?
I think I'm suddenly realizing I don't know you at all.
Listen, I'll gloss over the fact you killed my girlfriend if you kiss my sternum. The movie ends abruptly when zombie demon Bone shows up and attacks Jesse, who retaliates by tearing Bone's face off because he desperately wants to eat the fruit roll-up it's apparently made of. Had I not just watched Jesse struggle to remove the latex flesh from Bone's face, I probably would have assumed the actor playing Bone mistakenly opened the Ark of the Covenant and found the original negative to Demon Queen. In a confusing act of defiance, Lucinda is destroyed at the hands of her own demon henchman after he takes a bite out of her throat and reduces her to a charred-looking Muppet. Luckily, Jesse Pesci is there to mourn her demise. What the fuck did I just watch? I feel if you were to ask me what I sat through during the majority of Demon Queen, I would blank out, stare into space, and say,
Alright. Oh, you got to be kidding me.
Don't touch it. I'll do it. Ha ha ha!